walking in the sky.
Let me check my clock. Hey, you're right. We're living legend.
And Bill Kreutzmann, both of the Seven Walkers, and of course, the Grateful Dead fame with Bill. First of all, thank you guys for joining us. Let's start out with Seven Walkers. Let's start with the record, I think. I think that'd be a great place to start because the record was just phenomenal. We haven't ever talked about it on an Honest Tune yet, at least, with you guys. We reviewed it. It came at number one with everybody on our Best Of year last year.
Right on.
And so let's talk about that a little bit. Are you guys planning on going to the studio again? And if so, do you think you can get with Robert Hunter again? Is that part of the plan?
It's already in the process.
Is that right?
Yeah, in fact, pretty much as soon as the new record came out, he started sending more songs, and we've been working on them. And also, we have a live record that's going to come out in the interim. But so, because we like to take our time in the studio, you know, it took us almost 9 months to make that first record, and we don't want to rush the next one out. So, but we also have some great live recordings from New Orleans. Live at Tipitina's, and from the Great American Music Hall in San Francisco. And after reviewing some of the other live shows, we might even put some of the New York show on there.
Yeah, we should fill some of that out.
So it kind of would be, you know, the New York, New Orleans, San Francisco kind of vibe.
So y'all are like just remastering those, or how is that going? Is it along the lines of something like Dick's Picks, or is it kind of different than that? Or
it's there's hours and hours of hours and hours of tape that we have to kind of wade through to pick the best performances, and then at that point we'll have to remix and you know.
They found my own.
Get it edited into something that's cohesive, but. As far as a release date, well, it's a little too early to say that, but we are already working on the next studio record, too.
Great.
Sorry. Yeah.
It's great to hear. That's awesome. Yeah. Speaking of live releases, the Grateful Dead did just release One Out of the Vault.
Yeah.
With those releases, are those things that you like to sit back and listen to yourself?
I do. Some of them I do. The one that really comes to mind is I listen to Europe 72 a bunch.
I like that one too.
Yeah,
it's pretty good.
I like the one. I forget it was a hall in Germany. I forget the name of it, but we played the other one a couple times, and it was remarkable. And I never get tired of hearing music that's free, and you know, I just like
with with Seven Walkers. And you know, one of the things about Seven Walkers that's really awesome is that it's not just an attempt at having the Grateful Dead, you know, which is just awesome. That's one of the things that I think most people. I definitely appreciate a lot, but in terms of what y'all are doing, what are some of the things that are alike, and what are some of the things that are obviously that are different? Because there's a lot that's very different about what you're doing.
Okay, this is my take on it.
Okay.
Is that you know, with the Grateful Dead, Bill and his bandmates created a sound that nobody had ever heard before, and it certainly influenced pretty much every band since then that improvises anyway. Now, when you bring somebody like George Porter Jr. into the mix, and my background in being from Louisiana, then there's bound to be, even when we play Grateful Dead songs, there's bound to be a little cross-pollinization there, if you will, you know, where our swampy sound comes through and becomes something all new together. Altogether new, psychedelic,
swampadelic.
That's swampadelic.
That's your genre.
Yeah.
You might win a Grammy for it.
Actually, Bill coined that phrase.
Yeah. Well, I can be honest. My great lady Amy coined that phrase.
Is that right?
Yeah, she coined it.
Okay. she must be here.
She's around here somewhere.
Great.
I have relations from New Orleans. So it's always been a thing for me when I played the Grateful Dead. I never got to play enough New Orleans music. We did a couple songs, Ico Ico, Pocky Way, but we never really did have a real New Orleans feeling, right? And I just always was waiting, you know, to be able to get to do this. And when I met Pop, I went, oh yeah. And so he turned me on to, you know, like the first time I was down at Jazz Fest, Pop introduced me to some of the best New Orleans musicians there are down there. I felt more than just a little honored walking into this room with these heavies, and they were going, "Hey, Bill, how you doing?" You know, and they make you feel right at home. It's like, "Oh man!" So, felt I was in the right place, and I like doing it. I like playing the music.
And on that note, I'll have to say that Bill's introduced me to a few of his friends as well.
Nice.
When we were at the Great American in San Francisco, Bobby Weir and Mickey Hart came out and sat in with us, and there was a couple of times when I had looked over and saw Billy and Mickey and Bobby there and just had to pinch myself, you know?
Yeah.
It's like wow, this is going, and especially at the Great American Music Hall,
yeah,
which is so many great Grateful Dead shows were.
And that's
right on, dude.
And I think that was really cool. I think that was really cool that, you know, that there was, that with Bobby coming out, because, you know, there's been a lot of, there's been some perceived conflict there a little bit. It was perceived. I'm not saying it was, you know, perception.
Yeah, there hasn't been any conflict.
Right.
And it was just really great to have my brother come out and play, because we hadn't played together in a long time. It was so wonderful to have him and Mickey there. It was just wonderful. Also, Zikaru, a Nigerian talking drummer, played with us the whole night. He's played with the Rhythm Devils. He played the last time when I was here on the boat with the Rhythm Devils. He is the most wonderful. He's a master talking drummer, and he's the coolest guy.
He's a wonderful guy too. I just became Facebook friends with him.
All right. He can do anything on that talking drum. He can make it sound like anything. He can copy the guitar line, copy the piano line, anything. And when he copies the bass line, it's so funky, it's outrageous. It's on this little teeny drum. And gets these big old sounds out of it, you know. It's very cool.
At the end of that night, when Bobby and Mickey were about to leave, I saw them standing there. I walked up and said, "Man, just want to thank you guys for coming out." And both of them said, "Well, we'll always be there for Billy." Yeah. So if there's any kind of like, I think the fans tend to like blow things out of proportion and, you know, like take things for granted that aren't necessarily true.
I agree, and that's why it's nice.
It's nice to have something like that to say. You know, it's nice to play with my brother. It kind of says, guys,
it's wonderful.
You know, like, shut up, guys.
We've only known each other for how many years,
and
then come back together again is great.
Exactly. If there's anything that, you know, I guess when, you know, if you go back to the day that Jerry died, you know, and you go back to that day, and it's a horrible day, and, you know, but there's also been some beautiful things that have happened since then. You know, one of the things that I guess would be Seven Walkers. But what has it been in there for you that has been something to kind of fill that void of losing a brother? And then at the same time, you know, with Papa Molly, are there any shared qualities that you might see in him that kind of are reflective of some of those?
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. It's one that I'm very scared to ask. It's a brilliant. It's on a lot of people's minds. I was basically unsatisfied and pretty much lost for 15 years until I met Mal. Until I met Papa.
Oh man!
And I played. I love this guy.
I feel the same
way. And I played in the Dead, and I played in the other ones. I played in different manifestations of the last members of the Grateful Dead, and there were great musicians in that band. And but you know, without Jerry and the Grateful Dead, it would be like without Miles Davis and the Miles Davis band. So I always felt it was kind of hollow. And then I was lucky enough to meet this guy, and I saw him play at the Oregon Country Fair, and I said, "My, that cat is for real." And I went down and I introduced myself. We talked for 40 minutes, and Malcolm said he didn't even know who I was.
I didn't
go out and say, "Oh, I'm this or that," you know. I was
talking to him for at least 20 minutes before I noticed that he had a steely on his cowboy hat, and I remember that he had introduced himself as Bill, and then suddenly I put the two together and I went, "Wait a minute.
Could that be?"
I said, "Bill Kreutzmann?" He said, "Well, it's actually pronounced Kreutzmann."
Anyway, so I was pretty much just kind of lost until the Seven Walkers got started. It really gave me something to put a foothold into, something that my heart and soul really believes in. You know, it's a great, fun band to play in.
And I have to say, too, that, for me, it's a really, not only just a joy to play with Bill, but it's really, really satisfying to have brought somebody like Bill together with somebody like George Porter Jr. You know, it's like two musical icons, musical and cultural icons, you know, a bass player and a drummer, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like from different worlds, but yet the same.
Yeah.
And like the way, when those two came together, and that's when it really, the band really started making sense.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, now I see where this was going, you know?
Yeah, man, that was big for me. Yeah. I tell you, when Papa called me, because our bass player at the time, he couldn't make the gig, right? And he said, how'd you feel about having George Porter Jr. play? You know, and I got nervous instantly, even before I answered. I was, you know, slightly intimidated, because I know who George is. I have old meter records and things. And I said, yeah, sure. You know, I'm always up for a challenge. And I met George, and he turned out to be the sweetest, nicest guy who he is, you know. And a real fun story, we're playing up in Chico at the Sierra Nevada winery. And I walk in for sound check. And
our first meeting.
Yeah, first him and George. I got to play with George. First time George played with Seven Walkers. And I walk in, and there's George on stage setting up my drums. I mean,
he was the only one there when the back line arrived.
The back line.
And rather than just sit around and like wait, he said, oh, I might as well do something. Yeah. He started setting up Bill's drums. That's really funny.
Well, I'll tell you what, the love is apparent.
Yeah.
And you guys talked about the fun it is, and the way it's fulfilled you, and the fun that you're having up there playing.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, we're having a lot of fun out there listening. So
cool. Cheers
to Seven Walkers, and thank you both very much for taking the time with us.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I just want to say, too, that, like, you know, I know in my heart that I could never like what happened with the Grateful Dead was something that can, you know, it's totally unique in the American cultural experience. For me to be even a small part of that is just a treasure and an honor.
You're a big part of it.
It's just a treasure and an honor, man, it's
we enjoy playing music. That's the deal.
I've worked with some of the best drummers in the world, and this guy has actually the first one who's liberated me as a musician, completely and totally liberated me.
Wow.
So that when I play now, I feel like I can go anywhere, and he can go anywhere, and we're right there with each other.
That's because I believe in freedom. I don't believe in rules. And Coltrane has the best quote. He says, "Damn the rules."
Damn the rules.
Oh man, I just held on to that one.
Bill said that the early motto in the early Grateful Dead days was like. Every beat is the one.
Every beat is the one. That's true.
And because, like, in the school kind of where I grew up, like soul and funk and R&B, it's like the one on the one on
right,
the one.
Right.
You know what I mean? And like, once I started playing with Bill, I realized, you know what? Every beat is the one.
Yeah.